My name is Mel, and I live in rural North Yorkshire with my husband, three daughters, and three cats. This is my vlog about knitting, crochet, sewing, spinning, anything else that seems like a good idea at the time. Thank you very much for joining me today, whether you're new or not so new. I really appreciate you watching, so thank you. You can find me on Instagram as Funky40Podcast, on Ravelry as Funky40. And yeah, I think that's it. So, apologies for the light. I know I'm light on one side and dark on the other. You find me today where I do most of my crafting, sat in my bed, because mum-in-law is expected in the next 20 minutes or so. So I can't be downstairs and there's nowhere else where there's any kind of good lighting. So welcome to my boudoir. Oh, got no makeup on either, sorry about that. Okay, so I've got so much I want to tell you. Let's dive straight in. Is there anything else I need to say? Okay, so where are they now? The projects that I showed you last week, what are they up to? So let's start with the Weekender, which is my crochet project loosely based on the Weekender blanket, but I'm doing it in motifs and separate motifs and not joining as you go. So I've got another couple here. This black is glittery. I don't know if you can see it. You can see that. It's really nice. I don't like to work with black yarn. At my age, with my eyesight, it's not good. But this is really pretty and I love that one. And then this one is insanely colourful. I've learned my lesson. You'll have seen me learning my lessons along the podcast about this. So this one, I didn't mind having two different colours of lilac. And this one, I kind of figured I wasn't going to have another three when I'd done these three, and I was right, I had another two, so I've made those into centres, and so that's another two, as I'm trying to do two every, well, one every week. That brings me to 26, so when I get to 30 I'm going to lay them out on a single crook, because that's kind of the size I'm going for, and just see what they look like and see what I should do next. So that's that, just plodding away. Right, I didn't have anything to show you last time on my 4Cs project. I'm going to show you this now, and it comes with a warning. If you haven't watched any other podcasts, if this is your first one, then don't panic. This is my cluttered, clumsy, clashing, and I always forget one, don't I? Project, which is basically any sewing or embroidery or, well, crochet or anything else that I feel thrown onto one piece just for fun. Here it is. I reiterate, you are not required to like this, you're not expected to like this, but it's just me having fun. And as it turns out, it's me having fun with one of my children this week, because my middle daughter, Lexi, has been joining me. Now, she put this one on. Well, we did it together, but this is made from Thai silk. I went to New Zealand in 2000 and I bought a pair of trousers that were kind of clot type things, and to be honest, as a big girl, they were never going to fit me or suit me or look nice, and I kept them for years, and then finally I decided, actually, I think I'll get rid of them. So I made the fabric available, and I used the seams to make ties for bags. Probably got one here with one of those on. If I come to one of those later, I'll show you. And this is just another bow made out of it and sewn on. And I've done another load of buttons. This lot here, Lexi, my daughter, helped me pick them out. Over here we've got some really cute little buttons. I went to a festival this week and I bought those. And then this is just me using my favourite stitch. I am obsessed with chain stitch. With just any little bits of embroidery silk that I've got left over, just small bits. So sometimes there's only a few stitches in one colour. I'm just having fun with it. So just to reiterate, this is just a bit of madness, and it will be made into a bag when I've had enough of it. It's not far off, actually. I can see myself doing a few more of these chains, because I do love that. And I want to get a bit more blanket stitching. I love that. So I have made progress on that, and I'm stabbing myself. That's not very sensible. So that's the 4Cs. If I remembered what the fourth one was, cluttered, clashing, clumsy. If you remember what it was, do tell me. Okay. The 365 project. This is a embroidery and buttons project inspired by an artist called Lil Blue Boo, and you add a button or a piece of embroidery every day. Now, I'd really, in March, I'd fallen behind and I hadn't been doing it. So picked it up again in April, and I have done quite a few little ones. Again, Lexi's been doing it with me, which is lovely. On an evening we sit in here together. So there's some new ones in here, mostly buttons rather than embroidery. You might be able to see some of those. And we did a swap, and that's some of my buttons from my swap partner on here as well. It's starting to get to where I can't fit some buttons in, and I'm starting to have to think about filling in. I've been doing some knots. What are these called? Are they Russian knots? Or did I make that up? Some kind of knots. Anyway, I've been doing them wrong. So these ones up here, they're done wrong and they're going to unravel. But French knots. Knots. I think I'm getting the hang of them here. This is another advantage of this, is just practicing things and getting them right. I've got to hold it up the right way now so that Humph, the Harlow Nomad camera, is up the right way. That's the old rugby club thing. So there we go. We have made progress on that. Another long-term project. I do have quite a lot of those on the go at the moment, don't I? Right, Dave's socks, my husband's socks. He didn't go away, so I wasn't expecting to make a lot of progress on those, but they were the only pair of socks I had on the needles, and that meant they got more attention than they should have had. This is my mug that my children bought for me. What am I drinking? Immunity. Very nice. Excuse me. So they got more attention than they should have done, and I finished them. Now they're too big for the sock blockers, way too big, but I put them on anyway, just to show you them. So this is Drops Farble. They don't give them names, the colours names, I don't think, but there it is. I really like this yarn. It's a really reasonable price. 2.75 millimeter needle, which is a US size 2, and all I've done really is I've just toe up two at a time. And it's just a vanilla sock, except at the edge on the top needle, I started the row with purl one, knit two, purl two, and I finished the row with it as well. So around the edge here is that kind of little bit of rib, and then when I came onto the leg, I did it on both needles, so it's this little rib up the side. I just wanted a little bit of difference from a vanilla sock, so I wasn't bored with this. And I just wanted to give it a little bit more sort of flex and whatever. And then I normally do a one by one twisted rib, but because it was already in that, I just carried that up. I really like the way that carries on. I love it when the foot of a sock or the leg of a sock goes into the rib as if it kind of they belong together. I like that. So that's that. Obviously, I didn't use anything else for the heels or the toes, and I have got a little bit left, but not a lot, probably about 10-15 grams to make some mini skeins out of and put in my blanket. So yeah, really nice. You can have them now, I'll be very pleased. So at that point I had no socks on my needles, which is quite unusual, not hugely comfortable. So let's pop those down. It's such a mess here, I've got so many things to show you. Right, the other thing to show you is the memories blanket. Now, I said to you last time, I'm not going to show you that every time because one memories blanket looks more or less like another. Although I did hear on a podcast somebody was saying this week that you can really tell a lot about a knitter's colour palette and what they like by looking at their memories blanket. I think you're right. They are right. Let me show you. Oh, do you know what I was going to say about those socks? I knew there was something else. I think this pattern, somebody called Jo, who has a blog called Through the Keyhole, which I like to read, she commented on the podcast last time that she likes the vanilla latte socks. I was asking about socks that you patterns that you're obsessed with. Vanilla latte socks, they're a lot like this. So it's not exactly unique. I think that's probably where I got the idea from, actually. But yeah, the vanilla latte socks. That's what I wanted to say about that. I've got these notes down here, and they're no use if you don't look at them, are they? Right. So the memories. What can you tell about my colour palette from this? Okay, so I happened to have a quick look at how many blocks I had intended to do after our last podcast, and it was 425. And so I counted how many I had left to do, and it was 361. Now, I don't know what that number does to you, but to me, that screams one a day for a year, nearly. And that sounded a bit like a challenge, so I decided to give it a go. Actually, Zena from Little Yellow Uke podcast has done had that as a goal for a while, a little while back, to do one a day, or equivalent of one a day. So I figured, okay, let's give that a go, and I did. And I'm actually ahead of schedule at the moment, so I'm just adding new ones on. And that's good. I am definitely enjoying that. It's not sustainable. It takes about an hour for me to run the needles through. One I've already done it on. Yeah, pick up the stitches. Oh, I've only done half. Pick up the stitches, knit the square, and then run in the ends on the middle. Takes roughly an hour. So this whole project I worked out is actually about 425 hours worth of knitting, which is 7. No, it's more than 10 40-hour weeks, isn't it? If I was to sit and knit constantly 40 hours, like a full-time job, it's more than 10 weeks of that. It's no wonder really that a lot of people didn't want to do this. I saw a podcast recently where somebody had just done a few squares and they were ceremoniously ripping it out because they were saying, I'm never ever going to complete this, and it's unrealistic. And I agree, I completely agree. It's such a long term and such a big project. But I enjoy it so much that I'm carrying on with it. So at the moment, it's not sustainable to do one a day because it doesn't leave me an awful lot of time some days for anything else, but I'm enjoying it now, and there it is. Right. Okay. Oh, something else I wanted to say. You know the winter blues socks that I did? I'll put Piggy in. I had explained roughly what I'd done with them, and my design partner Linda, she said she didn't explain that very well, so why don't we write up a pattern for it? So she's doing that at the moment. She's test knitted it, she's test knitting a she's done a toe up, she's now doing a down. She's very thorough, is my friend. And we're going to release that as a pattern. It's just going to be a free download from Ravelry, but we'll be able to release that fairly soon, I would think. So I will let you know probably next time if you're interested in that pattern at all. Right. Oh, one thing that you kind of saw before, you know, I'd hand dyed some yarn, some Arran weight yarn, and I'd made a cowl in a colourway that I called Smoke on the Water, and I made another cowl in a colourway which was called Ocean's 11. And I showed you it completed, but I said I was probably going to frog it because it wasn't big enough. Well, I did, and I remade it. It's a very, very quick project, so it's all done. But I was really fascinated by the way the pooling, or the way the colours came out, really changed. I'll put in here a picture of what it looked like before from the last podcast. And this is what it looks like now. So before, the light bits came down in the line and then suddenly moved, whereas this, they're just shifting across the project. It's completely changed the way the colours come out, and it's perfect size. I had to block the Smoke on the Water one to get it to the right size, whereas this one is actually perfect as it is, so I'm not going to do anything else with it. So it's just one less window. And this peeky hole, actually, I'll take it off again because it is pretty warm in here now. So there are one, two, three, four holes in it, but there are five windows, I guess, five windows in the other one. So it's just a little less deep, but that's fine as it's quite firm fabric anyway. So that's it was a finished object, and then it was an unfinished object, and then it was finished object again. So that's that done. Right. Okay. New whips on the block. So, you know, I had done my dye one skein and then dyed another skein, and well, I've dyed another one. So, I had some yarn that I bought in Edinburgh. I went to Edinburgh 3 or 4 years ago, I can't remember. And I bought this. So, Shetland wool made in Scotland. Shetland cream. So, it's kind of undyed, whatever. And I decided it was crying out for a bit of Imagination. So I'll put in a few pictures here of the process. And then the finished object. One of those pictures probably has my skein of yarn on the right and a couple of smaller ones on the left. Those are my daughters, not Lexi, who I was talking about in a bit, the smallest one, Annie. She decided she wanted to do some yarn dyeing too. So, you know, I bought a pack of, thank you, Clyde, did you hear that? A pack of five skeins of undyed blue merino and nylon sock yarn to dye. Well, Lexi, Annie decided, the little one, she's 12, decided she wanted to have a go. So I sold her one of them and she dyed some yarn as well. So, and she has since knit with that. And then she's lost interest, but she really enjoyed it. And actually on the day I preferred her yarn to mine. I didn't like mine. I'm going to show you, what it looks like now. You'll have seen it in the ball, in the skein. So there it is. That's a pretty good representation of it, actually. Some of the greens are a little alive. Some of the greens are a little bit brighter than that. But so it's a whole range of different greens and some almost undyed patches here. That's actually a little bit green. And then the sprinkles. My mistake was I put three sachets of Kool-Aid in and I sprinkled. And I should have just done one colour, but I put all three in because I didn't think it would be enough. And it was. But it means that you've got some brown patches, which I'm not very keen on. So I just had a quick go to see what it would look like knitted up. And this is it in stockinette, or stocking stitch. So I don't like it. It may grow on me at some point. Or it may not, and I have had a couple of people from my knit group say they like it, so it's clearly not just me. I mean, it's not, you know, it's not just horrible yarn, maybe it's just it doesn't suit me. So what I'm going to do with that is I'm going to put it into my stash for a while. It can hide there for a little bit, and down the road I might find someone to give it to, or I might fall in love with it, but I think that's unlikely. So that's my dye one more skein. Okay, so new whips, that was one. Yes, I've been thinking for a while about doing the Selbu mittens, a long while actually. It's Ellie from Skein Deer knits pattern and it's lovely, and I've had the yarn for it since September, and I was thinking of doing it for a knit along in a podcast, but it's not garments, it's not big enough for the Little Girl You podcast knit along. But I started it anyway. So I am using this Drops Charisma in two colours. There's white and a teal, colour 73 and 19. I don't know which one's which. Teal. That's nice. And the white. So I got started, and do you know, I did a swatch, which is pretty impressive for me because I don't do them very often. And because it's two colour work, I thought, I'm a thrower normally, I thought I would use the left hand sort of continental style for one colour and the right hand for the other. So I did a swatch like that and I worked out my gauge, and I needed to go up a needle size from the original, but you know, Ellie says, you know, go up to whatever works for you. So that was fine. And then I started knitting, and I wasn't throwing with one and doing the continental with the other one, I was throwing with them both. Even as I was doing it, I was thinking, why am I doing this? This is not what I swatched for, not what I was planning to do. No. So, probably very different gauge. Can't really do anything about that now. So, let me pull this out so I don't. There it is so far. And let's have a look inside. It floats. It's not too bad. The only problem is I have quite, I wouldn't say big hands or long fingers. I think that my hand width is relatively standard, but even so, I can't get it just goes on, but it just kind of it stretches the fabric so you can see the floats underneath. It's not good, and you know, it's not the pattern, it's me, it's the knitter. My gauge swatch was done with a different technique, and that's got to be a classic way to mess it up, isn't it? So I'm probably at this point going to rip it out, go back and knit it again with larger needles. And I may also try and do the technique that I'm planned to, who knows? But yeah, I mean, it's a practice project. I'm surprised at how quick it goes. It's only 40 stitches, isn't it? So it goes really quickly. I've got this little ruler clip thing. Let's see that. So it clips onto the the right side of good. Clips onto the pattern, and then you move it down to the line you're on. You can see it. The best. It should be a bit longer, really. But I'm using that. Oh no, I shouldn't be showing you that pattern, should I? Don't know. I don't think it's a free one. Anyway, I'm sure you haven't seen very much there. So it is, yeah, Selbu Mittens by Ellie Skeindunitz. And yeah, it's a work in progress, but it's likely to be frogged and started again. I have actually got two balls of black and red, I think, to do another pair. Oh, the other problem is, of course, that my fingers are so long that I'm rather worried that the pattern isn't like continue until you're almost at the end, like it is with a sock. It's the pattern gets to the end. So even if I do make it wide enough for me, it may not be long enough for me. But I guess if I increase the needle size, then that will push up the row gauge as well. Who knows? We'll see. So that is my Selbu mittens. Planking. Right. Something else I started new. Let me draw that down there. Stormy Sky Shawl. Where is it? So it is a free pattern from Life is Cozy. And I bought this yarn from my local yarn shop, which is Yarn Etc. in Harrogate, run by the lovely Fiona. And I bought this yarn, oh, isn't it gorgeous? Oh, a year or two ago. So I'm sure you can see the gold filament in that, and the green, and the red, and the grey. It's lovely. The only thing is, let me show you what it is. It's King Cole Party Glitz. It is acrylic and PBT. Have you looked that up for me? It's something or other, Tetra something. Man-made. And it's lovely. It's really, really beautiful. But it's quite springy. And when you're knitting with it, it's springy. And I've knit with something like this before. Let me call it the Premier Wool Free Sock Yarn. My friend Doll Belly Knits podcast. She knits with it all the time, and she ends up with a 3.75 millimeter needle to knit socks, which is obviously pretty big. But that's because when you're just knitting normally, because the yarn is so stretchy, it pulls the stitches in. I've made a hitchhiker with it, and I had to knit without tension. Which is really weird when you're used to having a firm, you know, normal way to tension the yarn, to knit just at a kind of almost like I used to when I was a teenager, just wrapping it around the needle really. Have to do that in order to not pull it too tight. Does that make sense? Because if I just knit normally, I would normally sort of tension it like that, knit normally, it just pulls the stitch too tight. So I have to knit like that, not holding it at all. Otherwise, it's just the stitches are too tight and you can't push them off the needle. I'm knitting while it's knitted. You can't push them off the needle around the needle, and I know it's just going to pull it in. So anyway, I'm rambling now. So you can see it's got a drop stitch part, which is quite fun. Garter stitch section, and then a lovely eyelet section. So it is really, really pretty. I'm also worried about the fact that being the fibre it is, it's not going to block. So what I see is what I get. I could block it out as much as I want, but as soon as I take it off, it's going to go back. So if it's not big enough when I finished it, it's not going to work. But I know Yarn Etc. still carries this, so I can always get a second ball if I need to, so I'm not too worried. It's, yeah, shade 2354. Grinch. Is that the colourway? Grinch. I like it. Yeah, that's cool. So, I'm quite enjoying that. That's an easy out-of-the-house project because I do have to use to tick off on the pattern where I'm up to, which is a bit frustrating. But it's nice and easy. You can do it anywhere. Okay. Rita. I mentioned to you a while ago, I bought two skeins of yarn from Biff Sugar Yarns, and one of them was a teal called Lowther and one of them is a pink called Rosebud, and I was thinking I would use the Lowther and I was going to keep the Rosebud for you guys, but no. As it turns out, I couldn't resist the Rosebud. So I'm still keeping the Lowther for you. We're slowly trickling up on the subscribers, so I thought I'll set a target and then I'll give that away. Still keeping it safe. But I balled up, caked up the Rosebud, and yeah, it does actually look even more beautiful in the cake, I think, than it did in the skein. So, oh, same colour as my pillow, look at that. So there it is, gorgeous. Some really, really light patches and some really dark patches. When you're knitting, you suddenly get a really dark stitch. It's fabulous. Let me just get the label for you. There it is. So, you might know Danny from Little Bobbin's Knits. Wonderful, wonderful podcast. She hasn't podcasted for a while, which is very, very sad. But she has created a set of patterns based on a wedding ring. She bought a vintage 1920s wedding ring, which had the name Cyril Rita written on them. And she'd made this whole sort of story about who these people, these lovely old-fashioned names, might have been, and she created a pattern for Cyril, a sock pattern, and she created a pattern for Rita, which was released this month, and then next month I believe she's releasing the third one. I don't know what it's going to be called. It's all quite exciting and interesting. It's a paid for pattern and I'm not printing it, so I don't have it on paper, but it's called Rita Socks, and you can see it on my, if you go onto Ravelry, I'm Funky 40, you can see it on my pattern projects. So I've only just started, so that's all I've got. But it's a twisted rib, which I love. The thing with this is, it's cuff down, as you can see, and I haven't knitted a cuff down sock for a long time. I like toe up for so many reasons. I don't know, I'm sure there are lots of knitters who don't mind either way, but it seems to me that most knitters prefer toe up or cuff down. And we've all got our own reasons. Danny's mentioned her reasons for preferring cuff down, but for me, I much prefer toe up. So this is a bit not out of my comfort zone, because I have knit cuff down socks, but it's just not my favourite. So it's probably good for me. I couldn't work out how to, well, I'd struggle to cast on two at once. So I cast them on two separate needles, and then I put them together, because I'm really don't like the second sock thing. I need to knit them both at the same time. I'm a little bit off piece already in that I'm using 2.75mm needles, US size 2s, instead of what the pattern recommends, which is 2.25mm, which is US 1, because the middle size is 64 stitches, and that's what I normally do. I know it's lace rather than stockinette, so it's going to be slightly different, but I can always bodge it if it goes wrong. But I do have quite big feet. So that's the only difference. These are my Addies. No, they're not. They're my Sharps. Higher Sharps. Again, I got these to try them out because of Danny at Little Bobbins. Always loves them. Yeah, it's interesting to talk about needles for a minute. A lot of podcasters talk about the needles they're using. Chow Goos, Carbons, all that kind of stuff. And I don't really talk about them much. And it's interesting that when I knitted as a teenager, I had this lovely set of bamboo straights in a lovely little bamboo roll bag thing. It was absolutely gorgeous. They were so aspirational for me. I loved them. when I got them, and that's all I ever knitted with. When I started again, just as I was turning 40, I discovered circular needles. And I bought a set of Knit Pro interchangeables. They go from like 3mm to 8mm and whatever. And I thought they were brilliant, and it never occurred to me to try anything else. And it wasn't until last year when I started listening to podcasts and I realised there's so many other sorts of needles out there, maybe I'll give them a go. So I bought some higher sharps in my standard sock size, 2.75mm US2. And, you know when you're the kind of person who can't really tell the difference between a really good bottle of wine and a reasonably priced bottle of wine? That's me. So you basically don't buy expensive wine, right? Well, this is me with needles. I actually really don't tell the difference between them. I bought some carbons as well to try those out, but I bought the 4mm in those and I haven't had a chance to use those yet. But really, as I'm knitting, I'm not particularly aware that I'm using these or the normal ones, my Knit Pros, so I don't think I'll be buying any more. It's good in a way because it means it's another expense that I don't have, but I don't really find a lot of difference between them, so that's why I don't talk about the type of needles very often, but being that these are my shops, I thought I'd mention it. Okay, so that's Rita. Why am I wearing my socks? Yeah, because normally my beginning socks are like a little bra, but they're not now. They're just like a moustache. That's nice. Okay, so that's Rita. So I've only got one pair of socks on the needles. I did say last time there's not going to be an awful lot of socks in my future because these are for the box of socks count. These are my finishing May pair. So I've got plenty of time to do those, but I don't know. Okay, so there's something that I started actually before the last podcast, but I completely forgot to mention it. So I'm going to start talking about it now. Bit of rustling. Have you ever come across interlocking crochet? It's also known as double fillet, mosaic crochet as well, although not an awful lot. I came across it, somebody posted on a Facebook group, Everyday Knitting or something, about it, and I had a look at it and I was instantly fascinated. My foot's gone to sleep, so I'm gonna have to move, and I hope the camera doesn't jiggle too much. Oh, it's fast asleep. Okay, so I had a look at interlocking crochet and I just thought it looked fabulous, and I've been playing with it, and here's an example. So you always have two yarns that are contrasting. This one is the same on the front and the back. Well, kind of, it's opposite way around, but. And I'm not doing too well with the border thing, so I need a bit of work on that. I found a crochet along with it on Facebook. Ilona, I'll put the name of it up here. And I started going along with that, but then I just got really, really excited about it, and I went out and bought a book. Well, stayed home and bought a book, to be honest. But and the thing with this technique is, it, you can see how they really stand out, stitches really stand out. There's some even better ones, and the funny thing is, they're not the same on both sides. So, one side, the other, completely different. And there's another one I've got in here. So this is a work in progress, but it's not a project as such. Oh, there's another one here. It's one side and that's the other. So you can see how attractive it is. Something I forgot to mention to you. I have decided to start knitting, teaching knitting crochet again. I taught for a couple of years, a little while ago. And I have been missing it, so I'm going back to it. I'm going to be teaching at my local yarn shop, yarn, etc. One of the things I wanted to teach, I'm going to be teaching Tunisian crochet and freeform crochet and sash busting and things like that. I want to teach this as well. So I'm going to put some work in on this. But this book is amazing. It's got 80 stitch patterns, so it's got things like, look at all these pictures down the bottom there. I don't want to show you the actual pattern thing, but and see all the different patterns you can make. And I'm just fascinated by it. This lady, Tanu Skalik, she discovered interlocking crochet, and then since then she hasn't done any other kind of crochet. She's just totally fixated on this. And the crochet along is using this lady's patterns with her permission and everything. So it's a kind of nice little bite-sized way of getting into it. But anyway, it is fabulous and I'm really loving it. So new things, going to cross over into new things for a minute here. I decided I was going to make quite a lot of these as just a square thing to use for a course. And so I didn't really have any yarn that was suitable. So I just went along and bought... Best way to show you this. Ooh, hey, almost there. 8. And this is just cheapest chips, Aran yarn. But I chose colours that I thought didn't go too badly all together. But there's most of them will link with at least another 3 or 4 as contrasting colours. Because I don't actually anticipate this, these are ever going to end up together in a blanket or anything. I think they're just going to be squares for classes. But the technique is amazing, and this the book has lots of projects you can use it for, bags and mostly blankets, really, to be honest. I haven't seen anybody talk about how you can increase or decrease with it. So it is pretty much a straight fabric. And if this lady hasn't talked about increasing or decreasing, then I very much doubt it's possible. So it's limited, excuse me, in its uses, but it's fabulous. If anybody wants to have a go, then, you know, let me know what you're doing, because it's fab. Mm. And go along to the Cal as well and take part in that. It's fab. Right, the interlocking crochet. Spinning. Well, I told you last time that I was going to a festival, it's called Spring Into Wool. All the links for everything I talk about is going to be in the Ravelry group. There's a Ravelry group, did I tell you that? It's called Funky 40 Podcast, and you can come along and have a look and join in and make some comments and whatever. There's only a few of us on there now, but I'm hoping for some more. So I put all the show notes on there, and there's a link to that down below. The Facebook page, group page, whatever thing. So I mentioned on that I was going to go to this festival called Spring Into Wool, which is in Leeds. I think a lot of other people that I know were actually there, but I didn't see many. So it was quite a small festival in a school. I put some pics in here of the festival. But surprisingly, I didn't actually buy much. Beautiful, beautiful yarn, as you can see. But we looked around, me and my design partner Linda looked around at all the stalls, then we went and had a workshop, which I'll tell you about in a minute, and then we sat down and had a cup of tea, as we Brits do, and then I decided I wasn't actually that bothered about going back and buying too much yarn. Got a bit of a commitment to use up quite a bit of my stash. I don't have an out of control stash or anything, but I just feel like I've got an awful lot, and I've queued up a load of projects to go, and I didn't want to buy much new stuff, so I didn't. I bought some buttons, which I showed you in the 4 C's project, some ribbons to make bags with, to the ties of my drawstring bags, ribbons, and I bought a recycled fabric felted top thing, which was gorgeous, and I bought this. I'm in the right mess with this. DJ Crafts blank canvas. It is a double-stranded sock blank. Bits hanging off this all over the shop. Double stranded sock blank, so that means it's 2 strands of sock yarn machine knitted together, and it's nice and long. So what I intend to do with this is either to hand paint it, sort of lie it down and paint across there to make a self striping yarn, or I might dip dye it, so dip it in at one end and keep dipping in and in until it gets to about there, and then refresh the dye pot with a different colour and then dip at this end and then see what happens in the middle. I'll have a go at that. But the thing is, because it's a double stranded, I'd get 2 socks that either look exactly the same or that look like that, depending on how I want to knit it. So that's quite an interesting way of doing it. You know, as you know, if you've watched me before, I'm not a matchy-matchy girl. But this is just a bit of waste yarn so that you start knitting here. It's cool. It's really good. Yeah, so that's pretty much all of the yarn that I bought that's spring into wool. But I did a workshop and it was brilliant. I bought a drop spindle from Spin City. I'll put the link on, and some fibre as well. Gorgeous colours. Two or more years ago at the Harrogate knitting stitching show, and I did a bit of spinning and it was a bit clumsy and a bit rubbish. Sorry about the crinkling. Look at that. That is an unspun bit, but not very good. Although this bit was a bit better. And oh, that is a lot better actually. Look at that. Wow. But I'd kind of let it go and I wasn't very good at it and wasn't very happy with it. So, can you hear people playing the piano downstairs? Maybe you can't. I'll leave that for now. So, the workshop was by a lady called Fiona from littlebitsheepish.co.uk. And we got this brilliant box. So we paid £23 for the workshop, and we got this brilliant box with 100 grams of lovely soft fibre. You can see that with all this reflecting, and a really nice wooden drop spindle. And we've got an hour and a half of spinning tuition. It was really good. As you can see, I've still got a lot to learn. But I enjoyed it. And I got a better idea of drafting and all that kind of stuff. So, I also didn't realise that you're not meant to just knit with your spun yarn, you're meant to ply it with something else. So, after I'd spun a little bit of it, I plied it, plied some of it with, I've lost it, with some of this, with some of the cream that I'd just done, and I made a ball, which I now can't find. Oh well. Ah, there it is. So it's very, very clumsy. There it is. And I don't know what I'm going to make with it. I'm going to have to get some more practice. But anyway, a bit of spinning. I watch podcasts from like Anna at Dunkelgrün or whatever, and they just show us this beautiful stuff they've spun, and then you've got this. But if you remember from a couple of podcasts ago, this is about me. If a job's worth doing, it's worth doing poorly at first. And it is okay to be bad at it and to still enjoy it. I will do something with this. One of the podcasts, I think Danny from, keep going about Danny, sorry, from Little Bobbins had said that she doesn't know what happened to the yarn that her first hand spun. I think it was Danny that said that. But I will know what's going to happen to my first hand spun because here it is and I'm going to make something with it that I can keep and be proud of. I have also, as well as, oh, it's not coming out so well. That's actually greens, colours and blues, and a bit of Stellina. I've also got that, so I've got plenty to go at, but I do need a lot more practice. So, that's my spinning. What else? Oh yeah, I'm going on a trip in May. Hubby is taking me away to Curaçao. I don't know how you pronounce it. So, knitting on a plane. I haven't knitted on a plane at all ever. I've crocheted and we'd never take hold luggage, so I've always just had crochet projects on me and in the in my bag, my carry-on. But I've never risked knitting needles. But everybody says it's all fine, it's all fine. I say, oh, you know, the worst that will happen is they'll cut, they'll take your needles away. Well, that's not the worst that can happen. The worst that can happen is I've got a week of holiday with no knitting or crochet to do. That is absolutely the worst. And I don't know if there are any yarn shops on Curaçao, but I doubt I'll be able to get to one from the resort we're in. So I have bought these. So I can put a sock project onto these and they won't show up on the, you know, x-ray thing in my bag. And they shouldn't be a problem even if they do because they're wooden. And then if I had two sock projects I want to take, then I might risk the metal needles for the other project. Or I might put the metal needles still have to be in my bag, won't they? I don't know. I might risk that But at least I'll have some needles to, if it goes belly up. And then a crochet project. Now, I wanted to do Hotel of Bees, crochet project while I'm away. Saw that on the Lottie and Albert podcast. It is gorgeous. So I've ordered the yarn for that because my local yarn shop didn't have it. I'm throwing everything in together here. Right. Okay, I think I've probably covered everything I've done. Where are they now? New whips on the block and something new, all my new stuff. Oh, one more thing. I went to an open evening at the yarn shop yesterday and I bought that yarn that I showed you, the eight balls of just plain stuff. This for socks for hubby. His company colours are pink. So I usually knit him socks that have got a bit of pink in them. It doesn't seem to have a colourway name, but this is 007 Grundle Hot Socks. There's a thing on the side of how it looks, and our yarn shop is brilliant. You know, when you look at something in a skein or a ball, you think, yeah, but what does it look like in a sock? They don't all have that on the side, but they've got these sample socks knit up. It's really, really great, so you know what they look like. I might do another slip stitch sock with that. Got the same problem as with the West Yorkshire spinners in that these two colours are going to be difficult for me to tell apart, but I think I can handle that. So I might do another slip stitch sock for Dave. So I'll have those on the needle. So I might take those away with me as well. So that's that. So plans. Nothing much really. I'm just pottering away at what I'm doing. My yarn dyeing friend Kathy is sending me some of the Easter egg dye kits. Hasn't come yet, and I'm hoping it comes tomorrow because we're planning to dye a skein of yarn together on Sunday to knit a project called the Bird of Fire, which has one skein of hand dyed yarn and one skein of dark sock yarn, and you put them together. Looks lovely. So we're hoping to. If I wait till the afternoon, she dyes in the morning, then we're dyeing at the same time. It's great. So we're hoping to do that if it comes on time. And if it doesn't, then I suspect I will be dip dyeing this little baby. So it's another pair of socks that I might cast on for the trip. Okay, so I think that's everything. If you've made it all the way to the end with me, then thank you very much for sticking around. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up down there. And if you want to hear more, then please subscribe. And come along over to the face the Ravelry page. I think I might just post in everything and just get things moving about. We've not got many members over there just yet. But I'm just hoping that we can get some lively conversation. I do love a bit of conversation. So if you've any comments on what I've talked about today, anything you want to say, any constructive criticism, or just things you want to say, yeah, I've done that, or that Hotel of Bees is really good, or anything, just please just pop me a message on. I really, really enjoy getting some responses from people. And come along over to the Ravelry page and have a look and have a comment on there. So I'll see you in a couple of weeks' time. Happy crafting in the meantime, and that's it. Thank you. Bye.